Let me read to you something that I found on a Starbucks poster in New York about 2 years ago. It's on diversity. I quote, "America is a land rich in diversity, an eclectic blend of traditions. What coffee lovers want most in their cup?" That's a question. What do coffee lovers want most in their cup? A blend of coffee that is as unique as the person who drinks it. There then follows a list of ethnic coffees. Somalian coffee, Kenyan coffee, South African coffee, Italian coffee, etc., etc., etc. Now, I just wanted to ask you, what relation you see between this quotation that I just gave you on the matter of the use or non-use of the etc. To narrow it down a bit. Do you see why I have this in my section on the etc.? As an example, I'm making things easier on the second, as an example of the non-use of the etc. You might have thought it was an example of the use of the etc. There's a whole list of ethnic coffees. And there may even be an etc. on the world most direction. Let's all be surprised if there's literal etc. on the list. What do you think? Don't take too long with this list.
Is it because the etc.
was
because what they give you is already
learned
told what it is,
and
you're told what the
sentence
is,
you're
not filling in?
Yeah, okay, well, that's a good point. However, let's say that there is an etc. to indicate that the list is not complete. So then I would still say that it's an example of non-use of the etc. How's that for a puzzle? A land rich in diversity. Everyone wants a cup of coffee as unique as the person who drinks it. And then there's a list of ethnic labels. The people who wrote this poster are presupposing that if they give you a coffee that suits your ethnic identity, then they're treating you as unique. So this is a non-use of the etc. in the second form. That is that even if we say all that it is possible to say about whatever, which of course is never the case, but even if it were possible to say everything that is possible to say about happening, it still doesn't refer to, it still doesn't encompass, well, let's just call it the object of it, that which is beyond sayings, which is beyond sayings and prior to sayings. Possible to contain within any set of sayings whatsoever. Hyphens. So the Aristotelian orientation is elementalistic in that it takes as actually separate, that is, separate at the object level and perhaps also at the event level, actually separate, that is, as elements. Whatevers are only separable in language, or separable only in language. And I've already touched on this and given some examples, such as body-mind, space-time, organism-environment. Let's take organism-environment as a prototype. So the hyphen shows that they are not separate. That's the way Krasinski uses the hyphen as a device. Hyphen to show that they're not separate, and also puts each in quotes to show that they're not separate. So either or both of those devices. And Korzybski also mentions, and if I had time, I would spend 5-10 minutes on each, fact doctrine. Fact doctrine. Observer observed. And he also gives the example that we talked about before, the term evaluation, instead of either thinking or feeling. Instead of think hyphen feel, you just say evaluation. One would actually prefer it if one came up with a new word that was non-elementalistic, So we didn't even have to use the closing arguments. Just went directly to a new term. Like evaluation instead of thinking, feeling. And formulation is interesting. Instead of person and idea. Because the term formulation presupposes a formulator. So you could say idea and take it in something like the Platonic sense of a freestanding idea that would be there without anyone to ideate the idea. But formulation is a non-elementalist term per se. Actually, we should say in terms of the new physics, not just space-time, but space-time-matter. I could talk for 10 minutes about that. Space-time-matter, I'll just say. If there were no happenings, there would be no space-time. Go figure. Yeah.
Just a little question about the quotation marks. So if they each have quotation marks around them, that means that O and E are not separate, or should...
If I say organism, yeah, and I'm putting it in quotes, I'm saying it's not separate from the environment.
Okay.
I'm saying it's an elementalistic term. I'm flagging an elementalistic term by putting quotes around it.
Okay.
So I could. And it's double whammy. I'm using both hyphen and quotes there. Someone once came up to Kwasniewski in a seminar, probably a philosopher, and said, "Mind and body are not elementalistic terms. Mind and body are two completely different things." And Kwasniewski said, "Show me." In other words, show me mind without a body or body without a mind. And the guy starts spluttering and says, "Well, I could show it, but not to you." And that's the story as it comes down to it. So the elementalism of Aristotelian language powerfully affects human experiencing in the sense of insanity, as we've already seen in relation to body-mind elementalism, which puts the mind in school, the church, and the body in jail. We could diagram it this way. Split in language, that's elementalism. Split where we live. Split where we live, reinforcing the split in language. Split in language, reinforcing where we live. That's what I call it for a damaged life. As the life world is increasingly globalized, smithereened, that's mine. We've been talking about this before. So I'm going to have a globalized smithereen. Because to me, globalization is the flip side of smithereen and vice versa. One could argue about that. That's fine. That goes together with the semantic blocks movement before, the semantic blocks between label and normal. Where I said that one type of block led to rigidity or certainty, and the other type of block led to chaos or confusion, and I said that the two blocks seem to go together. As a matter of fact, as a hypothesis for the social scientist, it could almost suggest that the heavier the rigidity, heavier will be the smithereening as a reaction formation, and vice versa. The heavier the smithereening, the heavier will be the rigidification or rigidity. As a matter of fact, in psychoanalysis, Freud suggested that the certainty of paranoia, that the certainty of the paranoid was a paranoid reaction to confusion, a flight from confusion. So So we could take this as a metaphor for Aristotelian civilization. And the more, the more. So now let's talk about, well, no, just a quick example because it just popped up here. If we think about the relationship between humanity and technology, we could very well consider those to be elementalistic and repair the elementalism of our life. And maybe there's a non-elementalistic term that would do away with the need for life, and that might be cyborgs. Now, we have always been cyborgs. According to the title of Don Haraway's book. But what I wanted to get to was crime. We saw it here first. Not everything, but many of the things I say will have been not entirely uncontroversial, but that's all right. Crime, I'm suggesting, is an elementalistic term. And I'll give you an example which struck me quite a few years ago. Now, in 1994, President Clinton introduced legislation in Congress that would have funded basketball courts in the inner cities. And it was part of the omnibus crime legislation. The idea was by funding basketball courts in the inner cities, that would help to prevent crime in the inner cities. And the Globe, April 22nd, 1994. And a very well-known political scientist in the US, a conservative political scientist, whose name you might recognize, but I'm censoring it. Penned a ferocious attack on this provision of the omnibus crime bill, arguing, and I quote, that basketball, has nothing to do with crime. Right, so he's saying basketball has nothing to do with crime. But I'm saying, and President Clinton supported this legislation, they were saying, in fact, that we could put a hyphen between crime and basketball. In other words, indicating a relation. Now, there are various degrees of relationality, of course. Indicating a relation. As a matter of fact, if you think of all the happenings that are inherently or internally related with the happening of crime, if you really think about it, then you'll find that crime really does deserve those quotes. In other words, there is no crime per se that exists apart from all of its, all of the relations which it contains. Just a few examples. Poverty. Everybody knows about that. But there's still a lot of debate about it. For example, conservatives will argue that plenty of poor people, there are plenty of poor people who are very, very poor and yet they commit no crimes. Well, we could look at a statistic like this. In the first year after they're laid off, American workers are 6 times more likely to commit violent acts than workers who keep their job. So, poverty crime, basketball crime, unemployment crime, hyphenated. Of course, you can still say lots of people are unemployed and they don't commit violent crime. Alcohol crime, I mentioned this before, alcohol is involved, wow, I said 80%, but here I have written 90% of U.S. murders. Is that a lot? Alcohol is involved in 90% of murders in the United States. I read it somewhere. But there's lots of people who are totally alcoholics and never can drink. So the elementalistic critique is to use that kind of argument. Well, there's lots that doesn't. Lots of X that doesn't involve Y. To me, this is easily dealt with the metaphor of disease. Let's take tuberculosis. Most people exposed to the tuberculosis bacillus will not get sick. So it takes a certain vulnerability to the bacillus to bring on. So in the same way, vulnerabilities might be involved, I'm arguing, are involved in these various other toxins. Alcohol, poverty, unemployment. Here's something that really startled me when I first came upon it. Nutrition crime. And it's becoming more and more conventional wisdom in science. Ever since Harvey Milk's murderer, what was his name?
Ken White.
Ken White came up with the famous Twinkie defense in San Francisco, which was considered laughable. That's just because we wanted to laugh. If you think about it, maybe it ain't all that laughable. The question about defense in the court of law is something fortunately we don't have to deal with here. British researchers have found that improving the diet of prisoners slashed the number of offenses they subsequently committed by more than 25%. Fish oil, particularly effective. So this kind of, I don't know why elementalism seems to go together with a right-wing approach in politics. Hey, elementalist, right-wing. Because it seems to threaten moral values, personal responsibility, hard work. Well, what about them? Okay, fine, just put them in quotes. Not doing away with them, we're just putting them in quotes. Okay? If you could improve persons' moral values by giving them more fish oil, would you refuse to do that on the grounds that fish oil has nothing to do with morality? Well, would you? You know, I have stuff here that I'm not telling you about. You can think about it. I've got race in my painting marks. A non-elementalistic formulation that does a lot of the work of the concept of race you have come across. It's racialization. Or racialized groups. I have a problem with the way these terms are used. Because one is trying to get away from the elementalism of race by talking about racialized groups or racialization, but that term itself is used as elementalism, in my opinion. That's one of the problems with non-elementalism. Non-elementalism can itself be used in an elementalistic manner. It's like the Buddhist conundrum about emptiness, which forces some Buddhist thinkers to talk about the emptiness of emptiness. There is no emptiness. Intelligence. Is intelligence simply located inside somebody's head? I don't think so. It's a lot like Whitney's sense of humor I was talking about last week under the rubric of the chain index. Slogan of the University of Toronto, not the official motto, which is so rarely seen these days, I actually forget what it is.
Velo to an arbor estim, I think.
Come again?
Like a tree through the ages. Like a tree through the ages.
Which?
Like a tree through the ages.
Like a tree through the ages. That's old-fashioned kind of slogan that we old-fashioned people prefer. To the kind of modern slogan, which is great minds for a great future. Which is the more elementalistic slogans? Do we have here progress or regress?
Well, under great minds for a great future, you could conceivably cut down the tree that survived through the ages. If it benefits the future.
You'd have to do a cost-benefit analysis.
What do we do?
About independent thinking. I mean, isn't that what we're all here for? To learn to become independent thinkers?
I was hoping to get plugged into the hive mind.
What's that?
I was hoping to get plugged into the hive mind.
Yeah. Well, you can't avoid it, actually. Hey, if this was a four-year course, I'd give you an hour on free will and determinism. Some of you may be hoping that I would settle that for you, and I can settle it for you to my satisfaction, but not this year.
Can you explain what elementalism is? Like, I don't think I'm understanding what.
Well, let's take which one do you think you understand best of the examples I've given?
Maybe the crime one, because you talked about it a lot. It doesn't matter. I don't understand what.
Well, let's take space and time.
Okay.
So
I think an economy environment might actually be easier.
Organism environment?
No, economy environment.
Economy environment?
Might be a bit easier.
Political economy?
Sure, yeah.
Okay, as I said before, this used to be a department of political economy. It mm-hmm. even had a hyphen in there, if I'm not mistaken. I don't know, it doesn't matter whether they did or not, because it wasn't Korzybski's hyphen, even if it was in there. So can you have a political happening that is not also simultaneously, in some sense, economic, or vice versa? So all of these examples are like that, but of course, again, with different degrees and qualities of relationality. Because there's no such simple thing as relationality.
Right.
Except when we're speaking about it very abstractly at the top of the structure of the method, then I can talk about absolute relationality, indeed. I have pages and pages here on stuttering. You might wonder why. It's because one of the early general semanticists was a guy named Wendell Johnson. who was a stutterer when he was young, and then he got into studying. So he became a stuttering expert, and then he discovered general semantics. And applied general semantics to the study of stuttering, and he found that, at least in many cases, stuttering in children, young people, was at least in part the result of attempts to force them to speak fluently. So that, for example, if you're the kid and your mother says, "Speak up, why are you mumbling? What is it with all these uhs and oohs? Just say what's on your mind. Relax." This would induce anxiety. And the anxiety would result in stuttering. So stuttering would turn out to be an elementalistic. Well, I think it was Johnson who actually came up with this term. I'm not sure, but it's a well-known term now. Diagnosogenic illness, which is an illness caused by the diagnosis, or inseparable, which you can say caused by an illness which is inseparable from these diagnoses. I could talk for a few hours about schizophrenia and the various ways in which different cultures have related to phenomena which we label as schizophrenic, shamanism, prophecy. The prophet Ezekiel. Have you looked lately at the book of Ezekiel in the Old Testament? Blow your mind. You'll be getting electroshock treatments at this very moment. Okay. And one reason I've been moving so quickly through a wealth of examples I wanted to get to this, which I just discovered a couple years ago. And it's something of which I think Krasinski would approve, a new way of, a new device with which to undermine elemental world. Sorry, and it's the Mobius stick. And I'm going to apply the Mobius strip to the elementalism of society and the individual. For political scientists and theorists, this is probably the most fruitful elementalism to think about. Elementalism in society and the individual. I mean, which comes first? I mean, what is most important? Those are elementalistic questions. But let me talk more abstractly about the device before talking about the example. Well, one way of thinking about this is in terms of the elementalism of inside and outside. This is really outside. And yet, we can make it less abstract. Could you have an inside without having an outside? Could you have an outside without having an inside? You can do a lot in relation to various matters. Now, I found this, I'm not going to attribute it to Edgar Morin because it's probably been touched on by others, but I found it in the work of the French theorist, Edgar Morin, who I've already mentioned. And there's a whole bunch of stuff that he's written, of course, in French that is not translated. A little bit of it is translated. The specific reference I can give you on this is from a journal on nursing education. This is from an article by Corey C. Clark in World Futures, a journal called World Futures, 2004, and the title is Complexity in Nursing Education. Well, that's non-elementalistic for us to be learning about complexity from nurses, isn't it? Unexpectedly non-elementalistic. But anyway, this is my source for this kind of summary approach to Morin's use of the of the Mobius strip as a non-elementalistic device. Okay, and I'm arguing that at least for some purposes it's superior to codes and hyphens. Because if I hyphenate society individual, or if I put each of them in quotes, or both, the reader might still evaluate these two terms as having a separate existence, separate existences. The reader might still take the hyphen as symbolizing an external connection between the two, as in social contract, which is still the master myth of womanhood. I mean, Hobbes understood quite well that there was no society without the individual and no individual without society. And yet his theory was elementalistic. The notion that the individual members of society are prior to the society, become first, in some sense. Maybe not chronologically, but ontologically. The notion that the individual comes first and then that they come together somehow to form a society. And that we should understand them as if they had come together to form society, their social contract theory in a nutshell, that Rousseau is starting to break out of, perhaps. And they're externally related to one another through the contract among them, which forms social order. Now, this is still the way that we think about the relationship of individual and society, even if we think we don't. Even if we go around beating our breasts and calling ourselves communists. So with the Mobius strip, I'll hand this out. There are many, many ways of diagramming this. I chose this one because of the ants. You see why I had to have the ants. I'm thinking about some of them and I'll give them to this side. But there are lots of ways of doing this and lots of ways of imaging the Mobius strip. Matter of fact, it was discovered by, I guess it was a mathematician named Mobius. Yes, that's why it's called the Mobius. And if you go to the web, you can Google Mobius strip, all kinds of goodies will come up. Let me demonstrate. I'll demonstrate the minutes in small. So let's get as abstract as we possibly can and talk about the elementalism of X and Y. And of course, they are elementalistic terms. Would there be an X without a Y? Does the X come from Mars and the Y come from Venus and somehow they get together and establish a relationship? Or is the Y always already contained within the X and vice versa? Here's one way of thinking about it. This is an ordinary loop. This metaphor, it's a visual metaphor, Kozlowski loved them. You could look at them and feel them. It's a lot like the two sides of a coin. If you took out a coin, you could look at it and feel it. It has two sides. This has two sides, too. The thing about this, though, is the two sides never meet. So you go round and round and round on here and never get in there. And you go round and round and round in here. Same with a coin. You could travel up and down the surface of the coin to infinity and never get to the other side. So people talk about, oh, it's two sides of a coin, but that is still an elementalistic formulation, relatively speaking. Or they talk about, oh, it's the flip side. But that's still an elementalistic formulation compared to this. I mean, those are not useless metaphors. But they don't do the work of the Mobius strip. Now, all you do to create a Mobius strip is put a twist in the loop. Voila. I can't take a rabbit out of a hat. But I can destroy a civilization with one twist in the loop. Yeah, he's got it there. Yeah. And this is what you got. This is another way of diagramming it, very different. I have about six other images. So, if you, let's go back to the loop. If you took a paintbrush, dipped it in blue paint, then this side would be blue. The other side would still be without color. Take another paintbrush and dip it in yellow and the inside and the yellow. So we have blue and yellow. Two sides of the coin, blue side and yellow side. But if you've got a Mobius strip, then whichever color you choose, if you drag it along the surface, you eventually end up coloring both sides the same color. So we can see that X is in Y, and Y is in X, that X enters into Y, which enters into X, which enters into Y, which enters into X ad infinitum. Society, individual, or any other of the major elementalisms can be mapped onto the Mobius strip. Mind, body, I've occasionally used this diagram. Which is also kind of neat, but it has the same weakness as the hyphens and the quotes and the loop and the coin. The Mobius strip is the best way, I think, illustrating visually and tactile non-elementals and hold on. The Mobius diagram shows how X and Y do not simply influence one another, will affect one another while remaining essentially separate. They don't simply depend upon one another in order to maintain their separate existences. Rather, they inter-exist. That's a nice example. Inter-exist. Somebody has come up with this term, I forget, the inter-being. It takes me right back to Indra's net. Organism environment, tiger, tiger, the local two-sidedness which appears when we perceive a fragment of the string. Losing the hang of the twist. Because in my high school aptitude test, my lowest score was a manual dexterity. That's what my highest score was. Clerical.
Clerical pitch?
Clerical ability.
Ah.
It was higher than verbal.
And that's why to this day you are a rabbi. That's what clerical means, right?
So the local two-sidedness, which appears when we perceive a fragment of strip like there. There's two sides. There. Disappears when we perceive the whole strip globally. It is locally two-sided and globally one-sided. In other words, it is both one-sided and two-sided. Like this local one-sidedness and global two-sidedness gives the Aristotelian a severe headache. Since it violates the law of identity. It is one-sided. It is two-sided. It is both one-sided and two-sided. And this applies to any of the elementalisms in the Talmud. Both one-sided and two-sided. It is neither one-sided nor two-sided. Now there I'm applying Nagarjuna's formula, the tetralemma, which stands on four legs. Nagarjuna, the Buddhist philosopher of Hercules. This is his tetralemma. It is not. It both is and is not. It neither is nor is not. And a fifth leg, which appears in some versions, and none of the above apply. It is not one-sided. It is one-sided, it is two-sided, it is both one-sided and two-sided. It is neither one-sided nor two-sided. I only brought two tile ones. And none of the above apply because all these formulations are language or mapping. The map is not the territory. And this is not the territory either. I mean, that's a map. Neither linguistic nor sensory maps are the territory. All we have are maps. All we have are maps. This is the major stumbling block of general semantics, especially for Americans, to think that if they have discovered the object level, they've discovered the territory. Or you could put it this way, the two sides are mutually inhering. Actually, in the piece by Krasinski from 1943 that I signed, but I'm not discussing class, and in the full version of the course, I discuss it for half an hour or more. Krasinski says something like this. language inheres in the body. Let that stand for inheres in.
Is it mathematics?
Let that stand for inheres in the body, which inheres in what is going on. So you could do a sort of triple stretch of language in the body and what is going on. Okay, now if you look at the image of the Mobius strip with the ants crawling, you'll see that global one-sidedness again. And the ants can crawl from any point to any other point on the loop without ever crossing an edge. If the ants were crawling on this, they were crawling on the outside, they never get to the inside. If they were crawling on the inside, they never get to the outside. And on the Mobius strip, as is demonstrated here, they can crawl all over the damn thing without ever crossing an edge, as they would have to do here or in a coin. Go over the edge to get to the other side. Now here's why I insisted on bringing on this image with the pants. Although there are others that are equally interesting. Because somewhere Google came up with this in relation to the ant image. Said the ant to its friends, "I declare this is a most vexing affair. We've been round and round. All that we've found is the other side just isn't there." Cute, eh? We go back to society and individual. I could draw the thing on the board, but it's interesting. I've seen it done, but it's too difficult for me. Easy for you, difficult for me. So I'll go back to this as a society individual. Let's relate that to the C. Wright Mills formulation about troubles and issues that I brought up before. So here we would have troubles. In fact, if you think about it for a second, to say individual is to say trouble. I mean, isn't that what makes us individuals, our troubles? Well, I don't know about you. And here we would have issues. Of course, these days the term issues is used as a synonym for troubles, which makes me suspicious. So let's say that in a sane society, or a saner society, there would be this free circulation between individual and societal power, creativity, decision making. Map that onto all the stuff about semantic blocks that I was talking about before. I'm suggesting you do map it that way. So the society individual elementalism, which is perhaps the master elementalism of actually existing democracies, perhaps. The master elementalism of actually existing. So when we have that block, okay, now I can't avoid it anymore. So when we have that block, say, now these don't map onto each other perfectly, but they sort of correspond to object and label levels. So when we have that block, we have a blockage of this, the word body is an elementalistic term. We have a blockage of the social bodily process. the body politic is a nice term. An old term, but just still used somehow, but it makes some people nervous. Talk about the body politic. Talk about an organismic fallacy. I might get to it. So it's like a sickness of the body politic. I was talking about it before. If there's a blockage, let's go back to troubles and issues. If there's a blockage in the circulation between troubles and issues, you have the damaged life, which you can think of as a damage to the social bodily process. That's the pathology of actually existing democracies in the terms of human civilization. And if you want to look at, I say if you want to, because there's no way I can force you to unless I've made up another task, which I'm not going to do. If you look at a book by Asher and Gad Horowitz, which I mentioned before, called Everywhere They Are in Chains, Political Thought from the Search of Arms, the cover of which, as I've said, is the most wonderful cover ever introducing a text in political theory or anything like that. But in the chapters I refer mostly, we talk about the market and the hive. And this is before I got into general semantics, although I was on the way. And we hyphenate the market hive. And we argue that although political theorists like to think in terms of an opposition between a market society where individual decision making runs riot, and a hive where collectivistic top-down commands run riot, actually existing democracies are market hives. In other words, they appear as market at some moments and they appear as hive at others. Chain index, depending on context, to a very large extent. For example, in war, it's clearly hive. In times of peace and prosperity, it's clearly the market, but we got put clearly not in non-elementalist quotes, but in scare quotes. In other words, it ain't actually that clear. So that corresponds with the correspondence between rigidity and confusion. Also, starting for is someone making a documentary or writing a book about Pierre Trudeau called Just Watch Me?
Oh, the book was just published.
Book just published called Just Watch Me, which is a biography of Trudeau. Well, I was never a supporter of Trudeau because I was very favorable to Quebec independentism, so as such I had to be an opponent. You want to hear more? In 1961, I was probably the only Jew in Côte Saint-Luc voted for Pierre Bourdieu on the Rassemblement pour la Rassemblement de l'indépendance nationale. Did I get it somewhat right? But still, we all thought of Trudeau as a rights person, charter rights, made part of the Constitution on Trudeau's initiative, etc., etc., etc. State has no thing to say about the veterans of the nation, etc., etc., etc. But at a certain moment in 1970, the War Measures Act came down like bang! Like that. You weren't born yet? I was. I'll just tell you two things about the few months that Canadians lived during the War Measures Act. My brother Asher from Montreal turned up at my doorstep with his girlfriend with pamphlets clutched under their arms. They had escaped Montreal because they were afraid they might be arrested. I don't know what the pamphlets were, but they were not FLQ pamphlets. Somebody in the gallery of the Ontario legislature who was wearing a Quebec Libre sweatshirt was roughed out of the gallery and thrown in jail for a while. And I visited Montreal at the time, and have you been to Montreal? Mm-hmm. And have you seen tanks in this? And have you seen sandbags on my wall? What is that? It's from the Office of Coincidence Control. Have I told you about the Office of Coincidence Control? Some people believe in God, and I do, in some moods. But in other moods, I believe in the Office of Coincidence Control, which sends us interesting coincidences. some are actually very painful, some are enjoyable, some are funny, and some are just interesting. And this is an interesting one. Thursday, November 19th, a feminist biologist named Evelyn Fox Keller. Some of you have heard of her. I'm not quoting her, either towards the end today or next time. She was giving a talk at Scarborough. I don't even know how you begin to get there. but she's giving a talk at Scarborough called The Mirage of a Space Between Nature and Nurture. And I find this just a few days before I'm about to talk about it here, what I call that. That's courtesy of the Office of Coincidence. That's an interesting way of putting it, a space between nature and nurture. The myth or the illusion or mirage of a space between nature and nurture, which we fix with the hyphen. Just a simple little hyphen, but then of course you have to think about it a bit more. And there she is. Old enough to be a woman. Now, gene is an elementalistic term. Now, here we are, we're talking about human nature. So we put it in quotes. So next time you read in the press that the gene for Christian fundamentalism is being discovered, you can just put it in quotes. It goes a long way, just putting it in quotes.
Actually, the New York Times just yesterday ran a big piece on the God gene.
The God gene.
Coincidence.
Yeah, the God gene, it's the gene that is responsible for our belief in God. Journalists have a lot to answer for. Journalists used to come to the spirit course because some guy who's responsible for the Atkinson scholarships would send them from the Star. So I'd have 2-3 auditors from journalism. Then that guy quit his job at the Star and the journalists stopped coming. And of course the quality of Star journalism. We could put it this way, genes and behavior. Now this elementalism is becoming increasingly undermined within the field. Within the field. And Evelyn Fox Keller is one of the most prominent of the underminers of this elementalism. I'm going to give you some quotes from an easy-to-read sort of popularization by a guy named Matt Ridley, who is okay as far as I can tell. A book called The Agile Gene by Matt Ridley. I just realized I put this stuff on the board as if we were getting it, taking it down. Well, some of you are. But I'm not saying you should. It's just that's why I'm doing it. In case. So, this is from page 4. The more we lift the lid on the genome, which is the complex of all genes, the more we lift the lid on the genome, the more vulnerable to experience the genes seem to be. So we used to think of the gene as the motor or cause of experience, or the genetics, whatever, as the cause or motor and experience, but now you can put this on the moment screen. I'm doing it this way, but you can put it on the moment. They are both cause and consequence of our actions. And the genes are both the cause and the consequence of our actions. There's another cause hyphen consequence. Thank you. bad enough. But how this works out specifically varies greatly from one issue to another. What device is that in example? How this works out specifically varies greatly from one issue to another. What device is it using there? Chain index, yes. So it's not that we have the same kind of relation between genes and experience in every conceivable area. The way it works out in practice differs according to context. And he gives this example. And we're back to crime. And to, what's his name, Scott Peck's notion that some people are rotten to the core. A criminal personality, right, through the, even if partly genetic, is much more likely to be expressed in a criminal environment. So they're making this distinction, which is a bit simple, but it will do for us right now, between the gene as a potential and the expression of the gene given certain circumstances. So he goes on, a genetically jittery infant, jittery, like I was, reared by a calm foster mother, became quite normal. I used to like to say to previous groups of victims of the spirit that their marks could have been higher if my mother hadn't smoked when she was pregnant. Because then I would have been a more intelligent teacher, and of course a more intelligent teacher obviously is going to evoke greater intelligence in the students. Another element of tough luck. Depending on a certain genetic variation, some children become relatively immune to the effect of, this is another example. Depending on a certain genetic variation, some children become relatively immune to the effect of parental abuse on personality. And that some kids, because of a certain kind of genetic predisposition, you can abuse the hell out of them and they'll still grow up normal, whatever that means, and others. Will have been not lost, but maybe severely damaged. This is according to the present state of the science. Of course, this puts a crimp in the arsenal of those who would like to argue that all abuse is abuse, and that the consequences of abuse are always the consequences of abuse. Others require very empathic parenting, without which they will commit four times more than their share of rapes, robberies, and assaults. So it's possible in the future that with genetic testing we tell, does this kid require empathy or can I just say I said it seemed to be a little bit oversimplified. Gene logic, again, Ridley. Gene logic now seems to be, if in a certain environment, then develop in a certain way, rather than develop in a certain way. In fact, students of evolutionary psychology even think that they've come up with the answer to male behavior in love relations according to the degree of ease with which they can find a girlfriend. So in a context in which women are scarce, men will be, I don't know, I'm not going to fill it in for you. And then on the other hand, in an environment in which women are plentiful, behavior again will be different. And these people are suggesting that there are different genetic programs in the male which can be triggered by these different environments. It still seems too simple to me, but it reminds me of something I read about homosexual behavior in the former Soviet Union, which was that if you were gay in the old Soviet Union and you found someone who was willing to have anything to do with you, you would stick to that person with extreme devotion and loyalty through life because they were so hard to find. Of course, that's not our image of a gay man. If you want to induce moral behavior then among homosexuals, just clamp down. Right. You'll have all kinds of gay marriages that they will be illegal. There's a paradox. Genes are switched on and off throughout life by external as well as internal events. I like that formulation because it makes it clear to us that the events that affect behavior are not only external, they're also internal, outside the skin and inside. Genes, though, can be switched on and off throughout life by external as well as internal events. So Ridley concludes, it surely matters less whether human nature is more innate or more learned. That's just another way of putting the elementalism, innate or learned. Innate, life, and learned. Put them on the Mobius strip, innate, learned. So I've got more here about the idea that there's such a thing as a gene that does a single thing. I'll give it to you. When you knock out a single gene in an organism, it affects the expression, this is still Ridley, it affects the expression of more or less hundreds of other genes, and possibly all the genes in the genome, to some degree. So if you think of it as like this, you know, the genome, and you sort of touch one gene there, the whole web reverberates. What does that remind you of? Well, what does that remind you of that I've talked about this morning? Indra's man. Yes, is that what you were about to say? A gene is embedded in a, quote, entangled network of genes. So any simple Darwinian notion of what is going on during natural selection has to be abandoned. Whoa. Whoa. Any simple Darwinian notion of what is going on during natural selection has to be abandoned. Okay, this is from Ellen Fox Keller, and you'll see why I'm particularly enamored of some of her formulations. The reductionist phase of biological thinking seems to be drawing to an end. As she goes on, unlike chromosomes and unlike DNA, genes are not physical objects but concepts. Well, I didn't read that. I forgot that, so I reread it here. I mean, we can't see a gene under a microscope. What we see is a specified stretch of DNA. But which stretch? Maybe we should stop using the term genes, says Keller. Better would be genetic system. And then she says, and this is where I went, aha, we need to look at the linguistic habits underlying biological science. Oh, linguistic habits. We could sell her a few devices. There is widespread agreement, she says, okay, that we need to shift our attention to interaction. Okay, I guess it's pretty widespread. We need to shift our attention to interaction. But our language, as it's going to say, our Aristotelian language still gives ontological priority to the parts of the system. Says genes, the term genes doesn't have any meaning in isolation. So it doesn't have any meaning in isolation, so we put it in quotes. There is no inherently existing gene. There just isn't any such thing as an inherently existing gene. They are what they are only in a cell. One level up, genes to cells. A gene is a gene, that is, it performs the functions of a gene. Only in a cell, which turns nucleotide sequences into genes. Cells. find cells without genes, and identifying genes without cells. The cells turn nucleotide sequences into genes. Thus, genes don't create the cells. In the old approach, the genes were that create the cells. But now it's the cells which create the genes, so we have a co-creation of cells and genes. This interaction is what constitutes the parts in interaction. Now, this little formulation just applies to a lot of pathogens. And if I had time, I'd expand on this more too. We can talk about parts, and we can talk about interaction. Is this how I want to put it? The parts in interaction. Maybe Ryzen does better than. See, that's what I mean by
context will decide which of the devices does the work best.
I have a problem with that. I'm not sure what it is. But if we use hyphens, parts in interaction,
the interaction gives rise to the parts which give rise to the interaction which gives rise to the parts on the mobius. That applies to society and individual and a lot of the other elementalisms, if not all.
So then she says, we need an entire new lexicon.
Oh,
did I sell you some devices? We need an entire new lexicon. Maybe these little six-year-old marks might be a good start. An entire new lexicon which can represent this interactivity. Brzezinski wouldn't say represent, he would say which is similar and instructive to this interactivity. And she says it's time for a science built out of verbs. Not nouns, verbs, that is happenings, and not nouns. Nouns have gene. Some kind of non-elementalistic formula. Quotes, hyphens, Mobius strips, new wave formulas. Next one comes from our friend Steve Fuller. I mentioned him before. The quirky philosopher of science testified in favor of the creationists at the Boulder trial. Not in favor of creationism, but in favor of allowing the controversy to be taught at the schools, which is what they wanted to do. Okay, so Steve Fuller actually founded a new discipline. Now, you've got to admire someone who founded a new discipline. And he calls it social epistemology. Now, you can't refer to Korzybski, because I put a ban on. Necessary application. But you can refer to Steve Fuller because he's a recognized academic PhD, has published lots of books and has tenure. It's a term coined by Fuller to describe his approach to the relation between knowledge and social relations. Knowledge would be like epistemology, social relations, social. It's like Foucault's power knowledge. Fuller will leave behind the Aristotelian supposition that science is getting closer to a final truth, the view from nowhere. That is, that the knowledge produced by truth seekers is in principle, or essentially, separable from the social relations in which they are embedded. Okay, so we could map that this way. Truth seeking. Now that's a
That's an innocent hyphen. It's not a device. Truth seeking, maybe I should just cross it out so as not to confuse the confusable. Truth seeking and social analysis. So truth seeking is what we're doing here. And social relations is also what we're doing here. So there's no truth seeking outside of social relations. Well, there are social relations, perhaps, that are apparently used officially outside of truth seeking, but if we push it, we maybe we'll find that there aren't. So, do you really love me?
Yes.
The content of research can be separated from its social context. From the Aristotelian point of view, social factors can interfere with research, but they should not. So a lot of effort is put into creating the appearance that research goes on here without any influence from social factors. It's a little bit like the attempt to find the truth of LSD in a small whitewashed room or infant behavior without any interaction with adults. It's a little bit like that. A lot of these things, by the way, that I've been talking about here could be approached by either chaining nuts as well as by quotes and hyphens. In my experience, chain index is better if you're interested in real specifics, and the quotes and hyphens, etc., are better when you're working at higher levels of abstraction, as we have today. So from the Aristotelian point of view, social factors are not intrinsically or internally related to research, but Fuller is saying, yes, intrinsically. Intrinsically. The student-professor relationship, the granting agency-grantee relationship, the peer-colleague, colleague relationship, the donor-donee relationship, the larger society-individual relationship, they're inseparable. So the kind of effort to solve whatever problem by separating, it's sometimes like the effort to stamp out corruption. Have you ever heard of a society in which corruption has been stamped out? Other than Dracula's Transylvania? Do you know how Dracula stamped out corruption in Transylvania? By impaling. You could leave a wooden mold on the street in Transylvania and no one would touch it because they didn't want to be impaled by Dracula's cops. And it was a pure, virtuous society, not a trace of corruption. Anyway, that really is a bit of a tangent. I mean, you do the crime, you do the time. Fuller argues, all by himself, without any help from Kozitsky or me, that this attitude is a corollary of the classical Aristotelian splitting of mind and body. In other words, mental activity should be when it is searching for truth, free of interference from the body. Feelings, interests, etc., etc. So there's this moral imperative, this effort to free the mind. It's not just a mistake. It's not just an epistemological error. It's an effort. It has consequences. We'll see where it turns. Okay. This is how Fuller deals with the problem, because we're not saying there is no problem. Fuller concludes that because knowledge-seeking activities are always necessarily embedded within and inseparable from the social organization of knowledge-producing activities, then the question, how shall we pursue knowledge? Instead of evoking the answer, by pursuing truth for its own sake without any influence from feelings or interests. Instead of that being the answer, He's saying that the answer should be more like this. How should society be working? How should society be organized? In the light of what an overall desirable future would look like. So he's saying, instead of trying to make sure we need monks' money, we'll bend over backwards, not to get ourselves into a position where anybody could say that we're influenced by the money, instead of twisting ourselves into a pretzel like that, we should just go change the whole scene. So that an institution like the Monk Center would be funded in a completely different manner. That's like, how should society be working? In the light of what an overall desirable future would look like. In other words, it's not the pursuit of truth for its own sake, it's the pursuit of a better society. So in the pursuit of a better society, what should we study? How should the social relations within which the study proceeds be organized? Now that's why he went to Dover, and to testify in favor of the creation of freedom of speech. Because as I'll expand on next time, he's really opposed to the domination of experts over knowledge seeking. It's another form of the drive for purity. Expert is supposed to be purely objective, neutral observer from nowhere. I was once at a trial in which Shannon was a star witness, where Madame de Sade was on trial, and I was running a kind of bondage and discipline outfit. And the defense was arguing that SM was not sex, and that therefore it wasn't subject to the laws covering the sale of sexual services. And the judge kept saying, how many studies is that based on? How many studies is that based on? I don't know how you would study that. In fact, I don't want to think about it. So the question should not be how to make research autonomous, that is, purified of outside influences, but instead, who should fund it? And then what you get to is a kind of democratic organization, an egalitarian democratic organization of the pursuit of truth. And Kozitsky was already calling for the disconnection of science from the profit system. So then the question would be, how would scientific research be planned and organized and funded in a society with no ruling class?